Hey, Carrie, how are things in Maine? You getting some golfing done? I've been following your posts. It'd be fun to play some golf together sometime because you could see how laughingly my golf game is. I have probably played golf once in the last 10 months or something like that, but welcome to, let's see, got a small quartet of folks here. This is my second in my series of DesMondays, devoted to Paul Desmond, whom I have sort of, at least my career is linked to somewhat. I have a very successful CD that I did almost 20 years ago, which has been reissued and is now currently playing on radio stations. It's been in the top 100 on Jazz Week for the last, oh, 6 weeks or so, something like that. So it the enduring popularity of Paul Desmond for sure, carrying that one across. So I talked a little bit about some Paul Desmond stuff and last week did a few demonstrations. I'll do a little bit of playing, do a little bit of showing you some links and some stuff where you can find some information with this quarantine and so forth. You know, we all have a bit more free time on our hands, or at least more home time. So I've gone back and done a lot of reading on Paul Desmond and kind of going through, in fact, today realizing the huge amount of stuff that I'm still just unaware of. I haven't even heard that was with the Dave Brubeck Quartet. I mean, he did a lot, and he was with them for what? Well, that the famous quartet, which kind of started out in the late 50s and disbanded about 1967 or something like that. So a good decade of touring all over the place, recording something like four or five albums a year. And I was just listening to jazz impressions of New York, music I hadn't ever heard. And there's some beautiful Desmond playing on that. And some of their, I was going to talk a little bit today about the counterpoint playing. It seems that kind of counterpoint playing was a big part of Paul Desmond's musical makeup. And I mentioned last week, I'll mention it again, it's because it's really good. It's just a short little 10-minute video. I think the YouTube site is Sharp 11 Music. I think, yeah, Sharp 11 Music. I can't remember the name of the guy. I think he's in Europe somewhere, but he's a Paul Desmond fan. And he does a couple different videos where he's comparing Bach and his counterpoint that he used, like in the Inventions and the Fugues, with Paul Desmond's playing, and does very specific, so it gets a little nerdy, gets into the nerdy musicological theory type of stuff. The title of the video is How Paul Desmond Improvised Counterpoint Like J.S. Bach, and he shows several different examples. And he certainly did that with not only Dave Brubeck, who he is, of course, most linked with the Dave Brubeck Quartet, but he also did a lot of counterpoint playing with Jerry Mulligan, Barry Sax player. Those are some of my favorite recordings, are the Jerry Mulligan and Paul Desmond quartet stuff. They do a lot of kind of weaving in and out. It was very loosely arranged recording sessions in the early 60s, I think they were. There's two or three of them all together, the sessions that they did. Two of a Mind is one of them, and the other one's just, I think, Jerry Mulligan, Paul Desmond quartet. And they just picked some standards, and they had a bass player and a drummer, and they just played on the top of that. And with our current situation that we have had, I've been reuniting with a favorite one of my players to play with. I've noticed I have kind of that similar thing. I really like the counterpoint playing, the interactive playing, which isn't really part of bebop. So like the real straight ahead, kind of macho, in your face, lots of testosterone bebop isn't quite my forte, and neither is the modal John Coltrane type of stuff either, which becomes very physical type of way of playing. It's the more interactive way of playing, and that has to do a lot with the people I've been influenced by and studied with Lee Konitz. Lee Konitz is very much part of that from the Lenny Tristano school. They all did a lot of contrapuntal kind of playing. But my second album that I did, called Stay Cool, I did with a saxophonist from Los Angeles, David Sills, and we've been doing just kind of little back and forth, almost like, I guess, Sonny Rollins and John Coltrane used to do this, only with the telephone in their day. One would call up the other one and play a little something into the receiver and hang up. And then the next guy would, call him up and play the answer to that. So this long distance kind of antiphonal response, call and response thing. And so David posted just a video of himself that he did on his iPhone, just playing solo, and didn't say what the tune was. I think he said, "Guess what the tune was, and you can get one of my free CDs." And so I figured out what the tune was, played along with it, did a recording playing along with it, and sent it back to him, and then he posted that. So that kind of started. We've had about half a dozen or something like that, tune where we've been going back and forth. And then we started using a bass play along by a great UK bassist, Peter Ind, who was part of the Lenny Tristano tribe. He recorded with several of the on several of the Tristano things. He was over in the States in the 50s, I guess it would have been, but then opened up his own jazz club and record label over in the UK, I think in London. It was called the Bass Clef. Peter Ind, if you're musicians out there and you like these like play-alongs, it's just called Time for Improvisation, and they're wonderful bass lines. And I kind of turned Dave on to them, and then I asked a favor of him. I asked if Dave would record a couple so that I could kind of play some counterpoint for you. Hopefully the balance, I have a very low tech situation here. I'm probably going to need to invest in better equipment if this continues on, the lack of live performances we've been able to have. I fortunately was able to play at Boxley's this last Saturday evening. They've been doing streaming from their venue in North Bend, Washington. Smalls every day at 5 p.m. Eastern time. Smalls in Greenwich Village, they do a live streaming concert, which are free. And then the Village Vanguard has ones that are $7, but that's way less than what the cover charge ever was at the Village Vanguard. And they do those on Saturday nights and Sunday afternoons. Saturday nights at 7 and Sunday afternoons at 2 Eastern time. VJ Iyer, great piano player, was last week. And Joe Lovano's coming up on the weekend of the 4th of July doing his trio imagination group that he has. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm going to definitely check that one out. So check around. There's, some live performances happening, but here in Washington, we're still in this situation where, in fact, an interesting situation last week. Jazz Alley, which is probably the most prominent jazz club here in Seattle, had posted on their website and Facebook and everything and social media, well, we're going to open up again. We've done $100,000 worth of remodeling, and it is basically a restaurant, and all the restaurants have started to open up. And the state told them to pump the brakes on that and said, no, that's a you're a club, even though they have its tables, and I mean it's really it's a jazz, nightclub, but really a restaurant with jazz entertainment there. And so I don't know what they're going to do. They had a whole lineup of people starting next week, I think June 30th, in the first week of July. They were going to have some performances. Ernie Watts, saxophone player, was going to come into town. So I'm not sure what the situation is with that. So it doesn't look like anytime soon we're going to get back to any sort of normal live jazz experiences. So they're going to be, for the most part, these streaming and these kind of Zoom type of things. They just had essentially Ellington at the Lincoln Center, went in Marsalis. We had several bands here from the Seattle area which had qualified for that. Unfortunately, didn't get to travel to New York, but they were featured on the online kind of version a couple weeks ago of essentially Ellington. So all that type of stuff is still going on. So Dave and I had started this kind of back and forth thing, and I, to try to keep it honest here, I had not listened to these tracks yet. So this is as close to performing with and Dave is one of the guys. There's several people that several musicians throughout my career that I've found we were able to do this sort of interactive playing, and several I found I was unable to. That wasn't just part of their makeup. They didn't. So it's definitely something that's in Desmond's playing style, and there's only a bass line here, and Dave's playing, and see if you can guess what the tune is. I won't tell you right off, but this is based on a standard chord progression. And hopefully the levels are okay. I checked them earlier. I'm pointing my bell away from my microphone. I don't have a mixer or anything. I found that the sound is pretty good. You have to make sure you're not at max. If you've got your volume at about 50%, it should be a pretty good blend. So this is David Sills on tenor sax. Peter Ind is the bass player, bass play along bass track, and I'm going to go ahead and play along with him. I'm going to turn this up a little bit. It's a lower volume here. Oh, gotta make sure I unmute it. So here we go. along with it and just responded to it. It is the one dynamic that would change is that his is already set, so it's mostly reaction. So it's me just kind of reacting to what, and so he can't react to anything I do, obviously, right? Since it's already pre-recorded. But that's the thing you hear in a lot of Desmond's recordings, with Jim Hall certainly. He did a number of recordings on RCA Victor with the guitarist Jim Hall, and they would incorporate a lot of the kind of counterpoint. Jim had a pretty strong kind of classical background as well. You don't really have to have, a classical background to be interested in doing this type of thing. The piano player that I play with a lot and am able to get into these very interactive, kind of more organic line swapping things is Bill Anschel, and he, by his very own declaration, says, well, I was pretty much self-taught on piano. He came up as a clarinet player when he was playing in band, he's kind of digging into it quite a bit now, you know, later, and he's kind of going back and playing a lot of, you know, some classical music and stuff, and working on that type of thing, but hadn't had that much of that background. Jamie Finley, guitar player who I play with a lot, is a huge fan of J.S. Bach, and we've even played a few Bach inventions together, just rearranged kind of for alto saxophone and guitar. And David Sills, who I just played with. There was a guy, Dave Higgledans, a tenor player. He and I were able to kind of click and play in that same manner. So I've had a number of players, and I find that those are the musically more fulfilling kind of situations for me. And I tend to prefer smaller chamber kind of groups, even non-traditional jazz kind of groups, maybe just duets, trios, sometimes just drums and bass and saxophone, and eliminate the harmonic instrument, the comping instrument of the guitar or the piano, or just guitar and saxophone, which creates its own challenges. Jamie and I did a live stream concert way back in March, right at the beginning of all of this pandemic stuff, which is, I've cut into little individual tracks, and I was pretty happy with the play. I mean, I went over to his place and we just turned it on. We broadcast on YouTube and Facebook, and it came out, we were pretty relaxed, and the playing came out pretty good. I was happy with it, and the sound recording quality was pretty good too. I would play background figures and accompaniment. I emphasize that a lot in my teaching too, is that as a horn player, you should try to experience the tune as an accompanist, you know, much in the way that piano players is built in. It's baked into the way that they function in a jazz group, and same thing with guitar players. And bassist also, you know, they're constantly accompanying the soloist, but then all of us horn players and singers, I think, can sometimes fall into this bad habit of where we're the soloists and everything else is supposed to be accompanying us, and we don't really function in an accompaniment role too often. But certainly they do in these kind of West Coast cool school type of situations, and Paul Desmond certainly did in several of his different recordings you can hear. I'm looking forward to it's been a month that I ordered it, but if you're a Paul Desmond fan, you'll definitely want to get a hold of Mosaic Records, who does these great box collections, usually complete libraries, complete recordings of artists on whatever label. I think they have the Complete Pacific Jazz, Jerry Mulligan, Chet Baker Quartet ones. I mean, they've go to mosaicrecords.com and you can see their catalog and what they've got. And their most recent one is, I've got this picture, but it's a little, I got Paul cut off on the head a little bit. This is what the box cover will look like once I receive it. It's a complete 1975 Toronto recording. So the recordings he did with his, what was so-called Canadian group. And it's 7 CDs and something like 5 hours of previously unreleased material that the bass player Don Thompson recorded. So some really cool recordings, as well as Ed Bickert, the guitar player on the gig, had to be gone for one of the evenings, I believe it was. And so valve trombone player Rob McConnell from Rob McConnell and the Boss Brass replaced him. And so there's some recordings of just the trombone, alto sax, bass and drums, similar to what I just did with Dave, where you just have that the non-chord instrument there and the lines kind of weaving around with the bass basically is is functioning as the figured bass, we would call it in classical pedagogy. You know, it's the bass is just playing that bass line all the way through and outlining the harmony in a linear manner. And then the two horns, kind of by linking together, create that harmony that's going on. Hey, Dave. I need to be a fractionator. Okay, thanks for letting me know. I was hoping, I was thinking I would be too loud. So that I think I overdid it and went the other way. I'll play the other one too. So David Sills is listening now, ladies and gentlemen. Check out his stuff. He has a great album that just came out that features two guitar players and bass and drums and saxophone. So he's doing a lot of that interactive contrapuntal kind of playing as well. So you really have to kind of hook up with people that are like-minded in that way, that enjoy doing that type of thing. So I'll try the other one, and I'll see. I'll try being a little bit louder this time. This is the other recording that we did that David sent me. I've not heard this one at all. I think I heard a little bit of the other one. I don't know if anyone, we don't really have many people in here, so I won't even ask the question is if you recognize the tune. It was Out of Nowhere, the old standard Out of Nowhere. And see if you recognize this one in through here. So I will try playing a little bit louder this time. I'm purposely pointing my bell away. I've got, again, really low-tech sound quality. I've got a Shure Motive MV5 mic, which is nice. It's better than using your internal mic that's in your computer. And then this little, wherever it is, there it is, Bluetooth speaker, Boom 3 Bluetooth. So Dave's on the boom, and I will try to play a bit louder this time, or I could even turn Dave down a little bit, so we'll see. So here we go. Again, first time playing with this play-along track.
One, two, three. Thank you.
Peter Woods, not too far from Toronto. Well, yeah, and that is where that Mosaic set is coming, all those recordings, fortunately, that Don Thompson did for us, of the Canadian Quartet, as it was called. So so I'd like to thank Dave Sills again for doing those recordings for me, turning those in. Those, that's about as close to playing with another person as you can. Again, it's going to be mostly me reacting to what's already on there, and he can't react back to it. But it is kind of spooky. There's a few people that I've played with before where we'll be doing this type of thing, and we're going along, and all of a sudden we play exactly, without setting it up really, we will play exactly the same line or phrase or something. We'll play something that, like, in unison, or play something that will harmonize. And apparently, in reading, when you go back and read some of the stuff about Paul Desmond, which, again, I will make a plug for the non-existent book. It's only in e-book form anymore, but they sold out long ago of this particular book. But Doug Ramsey from Yakima, Washington, fellow Washingtonian, wrote this great biography on Paul Desmond. This is the coffee table version of it, some wonderful pictures in it, some transcriptions, which I was honored to have done one of them. I did Sacre Blues, one of the early Desmond Quartet recordings that he did. I think Gary Foster did one that's in there, and Bud Shank, John Handy, a couple different people. What happened was Doug met with Paul's brother, I believe. I think it was his brother. And he had unearthed boxes of correspondences that Paul had done with his father primarily, and so those are all reprinted in the book. And it's really interesting because you get into, I mean, his father was also a musician, was a composer and an organist, a writer and arranger, and so he would have musical conversations via these letter writing back and forth, and a lot of his insecurities, and especially when the bebop musicians really started to take hold, because Paul was right in the middle of that. That was kind of right in the late 40s, the end of World War II or so, when bebop kind of emerged, and that's when he started emerging as a player as well. And he just felt, he kept beating himself up over the fact that he just couldn't hang and play with that bebop stuff, you know, and he would listen to it, and he was trying, but he had kind of a different approach that he was into. And I think he and Lee Konitz really did kind of take the alto in a little different direction than Charlie Parker, who had a huge influence. I mean, it's kind of overwhelming influence. And I mentioned it in more detail last week about, it's interesting that, and I always mention this on my jazz history classes, that bebop, which it's at least stated purpose was to break away from the mainstream and be your own person and find your own voice and do your own thing. But Charlie Parker had such an overwhelming influence that if you didn't phrase and sound and build your solos in a manner similar to Charlie Parker, And almost everybody that comes after Parker in the bebop era, or with him, you're talking about his Parker-like lines, bird-like lines, you know, Yardbird. And the first tenor players to emerge, you know, when you have Teddy Edwards was one of them, who and Dexter Gordon and Sonny Rollins, who adapted Charlie Parker's language to tenor sax. It definitely happens with the trombone, with J.J. Johnson, J.J. Johnson's playing. And I used to have a demonstration that I played for my jazz history students when I was talking about bebop, a radio air check of Anthropology, Bird and Dizzy Gillespie's line on I Got Rhythm, where you hear a Charlie Parker solo, a Dizzy Gillespie solo, and a Bud Powell solo. And I mentioned the fact that you could interchange those solos. You could take the piano, transcribe what the piano player's doing and play it on trumpet, take what Dizzy is doing on the trumpet and play it on alto saxophone, take the alto saxophone thing, play it on the piano, those lines, because that phrasing was very much, they all spoke with the same dialect. And Monk was one of the few beboppers that really kind of went his own direction and got a lot of flack for it because he didn't sound like Parker and he didn't sound like those guys, right? So it's funny that a style that purports to be all about individuality had such a conformist streak to it. And it becomes really the model for all jazz education pedagogy. It's basically that bebop language because it's mostly boomers. These baby boomers that are coming up, born during that period with teenagers or very young kids growing up with bebop music, as Jamie Ebersold and so forth, and the guys that are North Texas State and the early jazz education models are using bebop as this language that you can kind of, you can really learn it like a language, like Spanish or French or something like that. But Desmond really doesn't have a lot of that. A lot of those birdisms, you know, in his playing at all. Much more of a kind of individual type of thing. But the Doug Ramsey book is available on as an e-book, so as Kindle and Nook and so forth. You can get it, and highly recommended. There's large excerpts from it that you can find online. You just do a little Googling. You know, Doug Ramsey, he has his own website and he's reprinted parts of it from there too. He talks about Desmond quite a bit. He was very good friends with Desmond, knew him personally, and hung out with him. I was very honored to have him do the liner notes on my Sound of a Dry Martini, Paul Desmond tribute CD that I did, and got to meet him. And he's a great guy. He lives in over in Yakima, Washington, which unfortunately is now getting hit really hard with COVID. It's kind of having a second wave. Yakima County over there is having some problems. We're getting a little bit more together here in Seattle, but hopefully all of you are doing well, getting a chance to get out a little bit, like Carrie, getting out and playing some golf. And it's a beautiful day today. We went out for a longer walk with our dog, and all this week is supposed to be in the 70s, and so it's very nice here in Seattle. So hopefully it's good where you guys are at. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on. So I thought, you know, I've been immersing myself in this diversionary stuff dealing with Paul Desmond. So you know, thought I would mention a few things. Last week I mentioned there's several transcription books, and I've got a couple of them. I think there's about four altogether. These are both Hal Leonard ones. This one's just some transcriptions, Paul Desmond collection, and this one that I use some play-alongs with, Paul Desmond 10 Jazz Favorites, and it has a CD track with it as well. So, and there's none of his solos really on here, or just little bits and pieces of his solos. There's a couple others where they're much more academic, where they break up the solos and analyze them and have these different little play-alongs and stuff. So. Let's see. So we're still down. I've just got about four folks in here. I was also going to mention, as part of Paul Desmond's career, he jumped onto the bossa nova bandwagon back in early 1960s, and he was still doing recording while he was with Dave Brubeck's group, and started his relationship with Jim Hall and those recordings, various different bass players and drummers, but. He did a whole album called Bossa Antigua, which is typical kind of Paul Desmond humor at work. And Bossa Nova means new wave or new beat. So Bossa Antigua would be old bossa, so old wave or old beat. And there's several original tunes on there. And Paul did actually write quite a few tunes. at the very beginning of today's little session, I played. So you can go back. I will post these if you missed the first part. You can go back, and I was playing Wendy, and I would probably say Wendy next to Take Five is Paul Desmond's best known composition. So Take Five, of course, he was able to live off those royalties after the disbanding of the Dave Brubeck Quartet. He got along great, just staying in his apartment in New York. And getting the kickbacks from all of the Take Five things. In fact, upon his death, he left in his will all of his for his estate. You know, his royalties, future royalties, went to the Red Cross, and the Red Cross was taken in. I forget one time when I checked on it was, I think it was in excess of $4 million. You know, that had gone in. And if you go to the wherever the Red Cross headquarters are, maybe they're in D.C. I'm not sure where Red Cross headquarters are. There is a Paul Desmond boardroom, a room named after Paul Desmond, fittingly, since he has contributed handily to the Red Cross. He had no close, real family members. So maybe that was not his brother I was talking about. Like, it might have been like a cousin or something like that. I think he might. I think he was an only child, now that I think about it. So, but there was somebody that hooked up Doug Ramsey with all of his letters, and those are all housed in the I think it's College of the Pacific, where the Dave Brubeck Institute is. There's the Paul Desmond collection, so all of these, the actual letters are there housed. Just like there's one college someplace that has all the Jerry Mulligan stuff too. So, I just say our own University of Idaho over in Idaho has all the Lionel Hampton. You know, there's a kind of a Lionel Hampton museum and stuff. So I'll play one of those bossa nova tunes to get you a break from my speaking and maybe kind of call it a day here. This was a tune called well, I'll do the title track off of Bossa Antigua. This is Paul Desmond's answer to the bossa nova, Bossa Antigua. Real pro version, so no coda, no little out chorus or anything on that one. Hopefully balance was okay. Once again, I tried checking it earlier, and as long as you don't max out your volume, you should be okay. Each of these playlongs had a slightly different volume level. The stuff I did with Dave was kind of at a different, recorded at a little bit different level than the I Real Pro play-alongs, and same thing with the play-alongs that are from the Paul Desmond recording thing. So, hey, Mike, how are things going with your new dog? Is the new dog taking to your saxophone playing? Hopefully that's working out okay. That can be a problem sometimes. Our dog is great. She's not bugged at all by it's fireworks that set her off. So we're approaching that time of year where it's not good. But my daughter's dog, which is a Westie, so those purebreds, they're a little bit more temperamental. And he's kind of learned to get along with it. I used to dog sit him quite a bit, so. But he did not care for it, especially soprano. I think soprano sax, of course, there's a lot of humans that don't care for the soprano saxophone either, so. So let's see. Mike, I don't remember if you were, I was going to mention a couple. I think I've sent you a couple things. There's that Mosaic set. If you go to mosaicrecords.com, the 1975 Toronto recordings. It's all of the recordings. It's actually the studio recordings that were released on A&M Horizon, which was their jazz label at the time, and bootleg stuff. But it's been, the sound quality's been improved. So I ordered mine about a month ago. I got an email back from Mosaic saying, you know, our distributor, the people that handles our orders, is swamped and it's the pandemic and all this stuff. So I'm looking forward to that, but it should be coming in hopefully any day now. So that's the, I showed it earlier. Here's my poor rendition of it. It chopped a little bit of the top off there. But the complete 1975 Toronto recordings. Really looking forward to that because there's 5 hours of stuff that's never been heard before. And again, a testament to Paul Desmond's popularity, which I knew he was fairly popular, but then when I did the Dry Martini recording and the reaction to that, I mean, we've had it reprinted like 3 times and it's sold out. I think it's one of the top selling Origin records titles. And it's been on the radio. I keep getting emails from John Bishop, and then I looked it up at Jazz Week. They're the people that track jazz radio airplay, and it's been in the top 100 for about 6 weeks now. So I probably should do a follow-up album. There's enough Paul Desmond material out there to warrant a second CD, and Jamie Findlay keeps bugging me about that. So, very shy dog. We can do a person in-person lesson. We can do an in-person. I guess if we're in phase two, Snohomish County. I don't know what Whatcom County is like up there. Mike Knutson, to let you know, I believe, I'm going to double check, but I believe we're doing a driveway concert in Bellingham at Steve Tate's residence. I can get you the address for that. But Jamie Findlay and Steve Tate and myself are just going to set up in his driveway. A lot of people have been doing that. I've been seeing people even, we might put it on Facebook too or something, we'll see. A lot of people have been doing things in the driveway and setting up cameras and socially distancing, making sure they're 6 feet apart or whatever. So this Wednesday night, I think it's at 6 o'clock our time here, Pacific time. 6 o'clock, 6:30, something like that. And we're just gonna set up in the driveway and do some playing. So I could see you in person if you've been getting out and about in limited quantities. I know they're starting to open stuff up a little bit. We have a few restaurants that have been opened up, but it's been a little weird. You know, they can only be at 35% capacity or something like that. So it's been going through all sorts of weird, different kind of iterations. But I'm going to do one more of these DesMondays. I think I've got a little bit more Desmond stuff I could share. I was figuring I had enough material for a couple weeks. I'll run down these again if any of you were not here. And on my The one I did last week is still posted. It's just on my just on my Brent Jensen page. I think I also reposted on my B Jensen Jazz, which is my business page. And so the one from last week is there, the playing and talking that I did. But there are a couple, in particular, one very good one. Yeah, I'll send you Steve's address, Mike, so that in fact, I need to look it up and see where it is. He is, I forget what part of Bellingham he's in, but I'll send you the address. I've got it here. If I mentioned this last week, and I've sent this to a couple of my friends, I've got a Facebook friend who is a saxophonist and music major, I think working on his master's, maybe doctorate. He's done a couple dissertations on Paul Desmond, and I've sent him the information on the Mosaic set. He was very excited about that. And then also, there's there was a television show that was in Toronto. We had a person from Toronto here earlier, I think. I'm not sure if that person's still here. Let's see, where is? Yeah, Peter Woods. So Peter Woods, Zachary France. We have two people from Canada now. It was a show in Toronto in the 70s, probably a public access TV show or something, and they did a half-hour show. But all you could ever find on YouTube was this little 10-minute clip of just Desmond talking, which is interesting. It's just the interview portion, but none of the music. Obviously, wasn't licensed or anything for that. But there was a guy that did a whole article on this reissue of the Mosaic Toronto sessions, and in that article, it's a very interesting article, but the real gem in there is that there is embedded in there the entire half hour show, and he's playing Take Five, and he's playing Wendy, does a version of Wendy, and Paul and Ed Bickert's the guitar player, is Jerry Fuller on drums, Don Thompson on the bass, so that group, the Canadian Quartet, and where that is if you go to it's jazzhistoryonline.com. Go to jazzhistoryonline.com, and if you just scroll down a little ways, all of the articles are kind of posted there, and you just scroll down and find the one on Paul Desmond. You could also just go forward slash Paul hyphen Desmond hyphen Canadians forward slash. That's a lot in there, but the jazzhistoryonline.com website will get you there. And you scroll down, it's a very long article, and almost to the end of the article, there's with the little, YouTube icon. You click on that, and the entire half hour show with all the music as well as the 10-minute interview is in there. And so that's definitely worth kind of checking out. There's a couple other, there's a jazzprofiles.blogspot.com. There's a couple really good Paul Desmond things there. I actually listened to, yeah, there's this week, so I didn't mention it last week. If you go to NPR, npr.org, there was a, they used, well, I think they still have the show. It was called Jazz Profiles, I think, on NPR. It was with Nancy Wilson. Nancy Wilson was the host. They've had different hosts. I think it's currently the bass player, McBride. I think it's Christian McBride, I think. I think it's the same series, and Dee Dee Bridgewater might have done it for a while, but Nancy Wilson was doing it, and it was in the early 2000s, mid 2000s, and there's an hour-long show on Paul Desmond that's very good, and that's just at npr.org. Go to npr.org and enter in the search bar Paul Desmond. It'll come up. There's only a couple things that they've done on Paul Desmond and Brubeck. So, and at the jazzprofiles.blogspot.com. There are a couple different very good long articles. All of the Don Thompson liner notes that are from this box set are, with his permission, reprinted there. And then there's Gene Lees, who is a good friend of Paul's, kind of a running buddy of Paul's, has a lot of interesting stories of just socially hanging out with Paul Desmond. And he does a piece called Paul. And that's also on the jazzprofiles.blogspot.com. So you can find bunch of stuff. Most of this, just Google Paul Desmond, and all of this different stuff comes up. So there's a lot of interesting Desmond memorabilia out there. Oh yeah, Paul and Chet's. That's right. There was a bunch of this. Was Zachary France mentioned that over here? That's. I'll probably talk about that next week a little bit. That's kind of the late Paul Desmond recordings in the late 70s. He dies in 77, and. Those are the ones I remember most vividly because I was a teenager. I was 15, 16, and I was listening to those albums, Concierto by Jim Hall, and She Was Too Good for Me. That was a Chet Baker album. There was a bunch of Don Sobieski, Giant Box. That was when I came up in jazz, was during the mid-70s, which was kind of a dismal decade for jazz. And a CTI and Kudu, those two labels. Kudu was more kind of the black branch of it because you had Grover Washington Jr., Hank Crawford, and those guys around that one, Esther Phillips, people like that. And then CTI was, Don Sobieski doing a lot of arranging and writing, and they had a whole stable of New York studio guys. But there was an album of Chet's called You Can't Go Home Again, which that tune was based on Rachmaninoff's second piano concerto, I think. It's also, I'm going to, rather than sing it, I'll play it for you. Eric Carmen, pop player, pop musician. So that's the actual theme from the Adagio movement of Rachmaninoff's second concerto, I believe it was. And Eric Carmen turned in Never Gonna Fall in Love Again. Never Gonna Fall in Love Again. I told you I wouldn't sing. So it was a pop tune. And then it's been repurposed for me. Oh, All By Myself. All By Myself. Is it All By Myself? Thank you, Carrie Baker. And Carrie Baker, you will remember from our poolside days, Let's Hear It for the Boy, right? Carrie was our singer for a little while there when we had the Red Line Riverside poolside gig back in the, geez, we shouldn't date ourselves here. That has to be 83, maybe 84, something like that. Pretty good gig when it ran from Memorial Day to Labor Day. You were pretty much playing every night. And so there was a lot of playing back then in that period, because we play 4 to 7, something like that, kind of during, you know, cocktail hour, happy hour type of thing, 4 to 7, when it was still sun out, and we were in a little cabana and we play, and then you could go and play like a Pengilly's or Sandpiper or something 9 to 1. So we were double booking gigs all the time and stuff. So it's crazy back then in Boise, Idaho. So stop giving us away, giving our dates away with how far back we go. But it's a beautiful recording. Don Sebesky called it You Can't Go Home Again, after the Thomas Wolfe book. And it's Paul Desmond's very last solo. And he was dying of lung cancer, so he had kind of, you know, breathing issues and stuff, but he plays beautifully on that recording. And so Zach had mentioned the Paul and Chet's Alone Together sessions. So they reissued all of that stuff. Sebesky had sweetened it with lots of strings and stuff. And if you go to Spotify and listen to them, you'll notice it's duplicated. It's not the same track. There's one that'll have all the strings in it, which are okay, some of them. But then there's some without any of the sweetening, where it's just, you know, the rhythm section group that's playing it through there. It's a really weird kind of session, because Michael Brecker's on that, which you wouldn't really think of Michael Brecker and Chet Baker playing together. But there's a couple, How Deep Is the Ocean, You Can't Go Home Again, which I think that was the very last. There's about three tunes that Paul was called in to do, and he said, you know, I want to do it for him, but, you know, I'm going to do it for Chet, because Chet's a good friend of mine, we go way back. And he was really sick at the time. It was just a few months later is when he passed away. So this was a couple months before he died. He died in May of 1977, and this recording session was like in February or something like that. They reissued all of the outtakes and stuff, because it had been kind of chopped up into different recordings. And some really interesting Chet Baker, some stuff. There's this tune called El Moro. Although I remember when it was originally released, it was called The Rape of El Moro, and I noticed they got the rape part out. So we're in the PC things or something, it's just called El Moro. It had a really trippy, weird cover too. The name of the album was The Rape of El Moro. I don't think you can find that album anymore. It was on CTI. It's from those same sessions. So that's some of the last stuff that Paul did. Paul did, you know, a bunch of pretty heavily produced things. The music of Simon and Garfunkel, there's a Bridge Over Troubled Water album that he did on A&M. Sebesky, I think, did all the arranging, and Herbie Hancock's playing electric piano on that and stuff. So, I mean, there's a lot of real interesting, diverse stuff. Like I was mentioning earlier, all this stuff on that he did with Brubeck, I mean, I was just familiar with some of it, but I forgot how long they were together and how many albums they did. And so there's a lot of Desmond playing out there that I haven't even, you know, really checked out. I was listening to a couple things earlier today. So thank you all for stopping by. I'm going to do one more of these next Monday, same time at 4 p.m. here in the Pacific time zone. And I'll do, last week I did this as the sign off, but I didn't do it with the play along. So I'll do a little play along here. I can't remember how many times this goes. See. Three times through. Okay, there we go. So, can't do a tune on, can't do a show about Paul Desmond without doing this tune. So, thanks. Hope you're all staying safe out there and dealing with this weird time we're living in. So here we go.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
It's a giveaway. We'll count down to 5. For hanging out, and hope to see you maybe next week as well. Take care.